Well, we start a new Bible series today, and this new series is, I'm going to entitle the whole thing, Get Real. This is going to be based on the Sermon on the Mount. So we'll be looking at Matthew chapter 5 through to the end of chapter 7, and we will see Jesus bringing out what the true realities of life. And my encouragement to you is get real. And I want us to look at each area that Jesus teaches on, because he is revealing things that were hidden, that people didn't understand. When Jesus comes on the scene, you have a whole religious structure that's in place that has nothing to do with the true realities of God. They had taken the law and they had turned it into something that was of no benefit to them, because they thought that they were law keepers. They thought they were righteous. And my friends, today many people think that they are righteous in their own. But we're going to discover as we look through this, what we need is a reality check. We need a reality check to see, well, what is true and what is not? What does God require? And what are my resources? And where do I fit? You want to be real about these things in terms of your eternal soul, because there's nothing more important than your own soul. Jesus said it. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and in the end he loses his own soul? Or what will someone give in exchange for their soul? So we need to know the realities of God. And they will fly sometimes in the face of what people have said, what people think, and what you might think. But I want to encourage you to bend your will to the will of God, because what God says will stand the test of time. So as we go through the Sermon on the Mount, we come to the place in Matthew chapter 5 where it says, "And seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying." That's the introduction to the Sermon on the Mount. And we are going to look at the first area of reality, and that is real blessings. Real blessings. You know, sometimes we think, oh, that person won so much money. Well, that was a real blessing. Or they had good financial success in a business deal. That was a real blessing. Now, they can be blessings, or they can be cursings, depending on what your heart attitude is, of course, towards those things. But real blessings are different than those things. And Jesus brings them out. And when we look at the real blessings that Jesus speaks of here, they are so contrary to the world's idea of blessing that it's like being on a different planet. Now, the Lord knows what real blessing is, and I pray that we will discover maybe a little deeper what the real blessings are in life. You know, often our whole prayer life is centered around wanting blessing, but usually it is not the things that are mentioned here in the Sermon on the Mount when Jesus says, blessed are those. It's usually an entirely different focus. And sometimes I think, even as those who have put your faith in Jesus Christ, you're not looking for the real blessings. You're looking for the, in a sense, the unreal ones, the ones that are not true blessings in the end. So this is a good reality check at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. And as a matter of fact, the very first one, which are called the Beatitudes, is the first statement is this. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Now, what does that mean? Well, the first thing we want to understand and explain is that it does not say, blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Some have actually interpreted it to mean this, so that if you're poverty-stricken, then you own the kingdom of God. And that's not the case, friends. It is not, you do not enter the kingdom of God because of your physical poverty, but it speaks here of being poor in spirit. Now, most people would think, if they thought this through, most people might say, well, surely it must be those who are rich in the spirit that own the kingdom of God, not those who are poor in the spirit. It almost sounds like it's backwards a bit. But my friends, it isn't. Because I must take the place, I must come to the understanding of how poor I am in spirit, so that I might be enriched by Jesus Christ, that I might be enriched by God, that I might understand that in myself I am poverty stricken. In myself I am needy, and I need the provision of God because I have none of my own. You see, when it comes, for example, to our righteousness, having a right standing in the sight of Almighty God, we are poverty stricken. But do you know it? The Pharisees in Jesus' day thought that they were amazing. They thought that they were righteous. They thought that they were law keepers. And they policed others to make sure that they were law keepers. You remember the story in the Word of God where two men went into the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, and the other one was a publican, which is a tax collector. And tax collectors were notorious thieves. They ripped off people. They were given a mandate from the Roman government to collect taxes for them, and whatever they could squeeze out of the people for themselves, they could keep. And they did squeeze. So they were hated, and they were wicked. They were thieves. But the Pharisee, the two men went into the temple to pray, and the Pharisee prayed with himself. He said, God, I thank you, I'm not as other men are. And he indicates to the tax collector, not like this guy. I fast twice in the week, I pray, I give. And so the Pharisee came before the Lord with his own righteousness, and spoke about his own righteousness in comparison to this thief that was in the temple. The Pharisee came near, says the publican, the tax collector, stood far off. And the publican, the tax collector, beat his breast, which is a sign of remorse and sorrow, and said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus said, Which one went back to his house justified? And lo and behold, it wasn't the Pharisee, because he came in his own self-righteousness. He thought he was rich in spirit. But this tax collector came with a repentant heart, who knew what he was, knew that he was a sinner, knew that he had no right standing in the presence of God, knew that he was desperately poor in spirit. And the result is that he went down to his house justified. So my friends, at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, the Lord Jesus is taking away your pride, your self-glory, what you think is real wealth. Not what you are, not what you own, none of those things are what matter here. What matters is how poverty-stricken you really are, how desperately poor you really are in spirit. You see, you will never receive the riches of God for your spirit. I'm talking about spiritual riches, not physical ones here. But you'll never receive His if you think yours are enough. And so what does Romans teach us in Romans 3:9? It says, speaking of Jew or Gentile, he says, are we better than they? Not at all. We have previously charged both Jews and Greeks that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:10. So there's no one righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everyone has. And so none of us are righteous. None of us have a right standing. in the sight of Almighty God in ourselves. We are poor in spirit. But if we do not know that we are poor in spirit, then we will seek to present our own righteousness like the Pharisee did in the presence of God, and we will not be blessed. But blessed are those who are poor in spirit. Oh, thank you, Lord, that I have nothing of my own, nothing of my ability. As an old hymn says, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Because the righteousness that I need has to come from Jesus Christ. And he's offering his righteousness. He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So God is offering us his righteousness as a substitute for our absolute depravity and poverty in spiritual realities. You see, the church of Laodicea, in the book of Revelations, chapter 3, verse 17, Jesus challenges them and says, because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and I have need of nothing, and you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. The Laodiceans were fairly wealthy people. And actually, they were speaking of their own physical riches and saying how rich they were. And they said they had need of nothing. And here's what the Lord had to say. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. So the Lord Jesus was pointing out to them, you're actually desperately poverty-stricken here and you don't know it. I have the provision, but you need to know how poor you are in spirit so that you might receive the blessing that comes from God. And so we are poor in our own righteousness. We have no righteousness of our own. And that's why the Word of God says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but it's according to his mercy that he saves us. And furthermore, not only are we unrighteous, but we are also unable to do anything that matters. You say, well, lots of people have done things that matters. Think of presidents and kings and rulers and scientists who won prizes and all the things that men clap each other and women on the back for. But does it matter in eternity? If you built the tallest skyscraper, do you think that God is impressed? He actually stopped them from trying to do such a thing back at the Tower of Babel because he considered it wickedness. And it doesn't mean it's wrong to build a tower. Their idea was to build a tower into heaven. Their idea was to build their own way to God. But friends, it's not much different today. People think that these are the prize things. These are the things that matter, and they give each other prizes and awards for all these accomplishments that end up in the dust of the earth. And all the while, God is saying, I've got the real riches here, but you have to know how poor you are, and you'll come to me, and I will give you the real riches. Blessed are the poor in spirit, he says, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus said in John chapter 15, verse 4, he said, abide in me or remain in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit from itself unless it remains or abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Did you hear what that the words of Jesus are? He says, without me, you can do nothing. That is nothing of eternal value. Nothing that really counts at the end of life. Nothing counts. Unless I remain in Christ, unless I know my own poverty and I must depend upon his wealth, unless I realize what I don't have, so that I will trust in what he has. In the book of Romans chapter 12, it says this, "For I say through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith." Don't think highly than you ought to think. Don't think that you are the cat's meow, because you aren't. None of us are. You know, we are so concerned about trying to keep people's self-esteem up that we try to inflate people and pump them up to be something that they aren't. And of course, they can't meet that standard. They end up being disappointed in themselves and everybody else disappointed in them. For the next new politician that comes along is going to be Superman. He's going to do everything. It's going to be perfect. And then, of course, never works out that way, does it? Well, it's like that in terms of spiritual matters. We can end up deceiving ourselves and lying to ourselves about how good we are and et cetera, et cetera. Patting ourselves on the back and looking for others to pat us on the back in thinking about how great we really are, when it's not the case at all. We are sinners who need a Savior, and we are unable to do anything of lasting value without the strength and the power of God Almighty, and yet He offers it to us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the Apostle Paul is writing, and he speaks about what happened in the Old Testament, how as they were in the desert, they sinned and rebelled against God. They went to sexual immorality, and they were worshiping idols and chased after evil things and lusted, and they were scattered in the wilderness as a result of their unbelief. They were complainers. And so he says, now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let he who thinks he stands watch out, lest you fall. Again, there is this mighty emphasis on how poverty-stricken we are, how unable we are, and how much we need God. So blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Wow. Listen, here's what Jesus had to say. Jesus said in John 5:30, I can of myself do nothing. Did you hear that? These are the very words of the Savior, of God who had become man. But he did take this place of humility. The Bible tells us in Philippians that he emptied himself. I can of myself do nothing, Jesus said. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. Jesus did not live his life or do the miracles that he did by his own power, but he did them from a place of poverty and depending on the riches of the Spirit of God to accomplish for him what he dared not do himself, because he had emptied himself of these things, that he might know the mighty power of the Spirit of God working, and that we might be encouraged to understand, if that was the case for Jesus Christ, what about you? What can you do? And where can you turn? Friends, blessed are the poor in spirit. These are the words of Jesus, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Yes, the kingdom of heaven. There's the promise that comes. There's the condition. And the condition is not that we are super people. It's not, oh, blessed are the super good ones, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the ones who go to church every Sunday. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who are so good living that they must be able to win a seat there. No, it doesn't say that. It doesn't say that. That is the way the world looks on things. We need to get real, folks. We need to understand what reality is. And the real blessing here is that we understand how poor we are in spirit and how much we need the person, the work, and the presence of Almighty God. Now, even for the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit came upon him when he was baptized. But he makes this statement after that. He maintained an ongoing poverty in himself that he might rely on the riches of the Spirit of God to work in him. So, my friend, I want you to know that if you want real blessing in your life, if you want to know the blessing of Almighty God, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Acknowledge your sin. Acknowledge your inability and repent and come to Christ, for he can take care of the sin issue, but he also takes care of the ability issue as we rely on him. Oh, the blessings that flow from God Almighty. This is the beginning, the introduction to real blessing. And I pray that you will know the real blessings of God, that you will move away from your self-sufficient, independent, proud, and haughty place, which, my friend, all of us have to some degree, and that we will humble ourselves, cry out to God. Understand this, that God's provision is better than yours. God's storehouse is full, and yours is truly empty. And he is generous, willing to give his very self to you so that you would know the real riches of heaven, so that you would experience the real blessings. Friends, I have discovered that the older I get as a Christian, the more I realize how weak I am, that I am poor in spirit, but that God has all that I need. And so I become not stronger in myself, but I become weaker that I might know his strength. That, like the Apostle Paul said, it's when I am weak, that's when I am strong. So, my friends, I want to encourage you with all my heart and soul to find the real blessing here. Don't miss this blessing. This blessing is the very introduction to the Sermon on the Mount. Empty, yes, but filled with him. I'm the vessel to contain the goodness of God, and so can you. If you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, it is the first place to come to. To know that you're lost, to know that you have no righteousness of your own, to know that you've come to the end of self, to know that you need Jesus Christ to save you, and he has all of that provision for you, and he has it for you now. So in the poverty of spirit, in the absolute inability of self, we find the real answer in the person of Jesus Christ. So, in conclusion, when we look at this wonderful story, what Jesus had to say here, he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." What a result! The kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is not just when you get there. The kingdom of heaven comes now. I'm in his kingdom now. When I trusted him as my Savior, I came into the kingdom of heaven. And so, if you want to be saved, if you want to have the forgiveness of your sins, you need to be poor in spirit just to get in the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. And those two are used interchangeably in the New Testament. So, the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God has come. And you enter into that kingdom by trusting Christ as your Savior. But if you're trusting Christ, you're not trusting in yourself, which acknowledges I'm poor in spirit. but ongoing experiencing the fullness of the kingdom of heaven in my life as much as possible while I'm here on earth will depend on how willing I am to stay poor of spirit in myself and depend upon the Holy Spirit, on God Himself. Blessings, the riches of the kingdom of heaven, not the earthly riches, but the true riches, are mine as I depend and live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. This song is a takeoff of the song Lean on Me. And I just put some lyrics to it. Instead of Lean on Me, Lean on Jesus. Lean on Jesus. Discover how weak you are and find His strength. Somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride if you have trials, if you have sorrows, for no one can fill those of your needs that you won't let show. When you're not strong, He'll be your friend. He'll help you carry on. Oh, for it won't be long. We're gonna need somebody to lean on. Just call on Him, brother. You need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. Oh, He knows every problem and He understands. We all need somebody to lean on. Lean on Jesus when you're not strong. He'll be your friend. He'll help you carry on. Oh, for it won't be long, we're gonna need somebody to lean on. If there is a load you have to bear that you can't carry, oh, He'll carry your load if you will come. His strength will hold you. Oh, lean on Jesus when you're not strong. He'll be your friend. He'll help you carry on. Oh, for it won't be long. We're gonna need somebody to lean on. Our load of sin He took to the cross, carried our sorrows. If you trust in Him, He will save you for all your tomorrows. Oh, lean on Jesus when you're not strong. He'll be your friend. He'll help you carry on. Oh, for it won't be long. we're gonna need somebody to lean on. Lean on Jesus. Come to Him. Come to Jesus, friends. Oh, you're poor in spirit. It's a blessing, because the promise is the kingdom of heaven. All the beauty and the wonder of the kingdom of God is yours, but it's yours in Christ and Christ alone. Amen. Real blessing.